All right. Well, I hope that you're able to join us, able to hear us. We've got Nick and Stacy and Doug in the sound booth, and Dawn traveled all the way, braved the weather to be here. So if you get to hear Dawn laugh, that'll hopefully be a blessing. We started this series on faithful all the way back on January 3rd to talk about what does it mean. Faithful with what? Faithful to what? We kind of asked that question. Jen Martin does our graphics, and I don't know if you can see it behind me or not, but she's got the faithful with the question mark. And so if you kind of think back over the last, you know, starting back January 3rd, Brian preached for us on January 17th, and then I was sick on the 31st, and so Nick preached for us. And then last week, our friend Nathan got to preach for us on February 7th. And so I just want to clarify, if you're thinking faithful question mark, the series was not originally designed to say, is our pastor faithful? Like, when does this guy ever preach? That's not really what I meant, although now it's kind of how I feel. And so just to let you know, we started this with the thought of if Jesus is coming back, and we know that he is, then is he going to be finding the church faithful? And so what does that look like for us to be found faithful? Just to clarify, whenever I say that Jesus is coming back, I don't want this to sound like I'm guaranteeing he's coming back within the next 5 years. He could come back today. He could come back tomorrow. It could be another 100 years, another 1,000 years. We don't know. But what we know from these passages is that it seems like times are progressing and that it should be soon. And so what we did in this series was we asked the question, if he was going to return in 5 years. We said 5 years because that way it kind of gives us a little bit of time to say, let's be strategic to think about making the right changes, both with our own personal habits, but then also not just as individuals, but as a church, what are the things we would want to be doing? And so we've been asking this question, faithful with what and to what? We've been going through Matthew 24 and Matthew 25. So this week, we're going to finish Matthew 25, and then I hope to invite you, hopefully the weather's clear and everything, next Sunday, we're going to kind of unpack what we would want our church's five-year plan to really look like. And so I've never done a message like that, by the way. I'm extremely nervous. But so next week, I hope you could make plans to be here, to join us through Facebook Live, and we're going to talk about what would it mean to be faithful. And I've tried to not answer this question, just instead to preach the text, and that way as you're praying through it and thinking about it, dreaming about it, what would it be like as a church if we were to look, you know, what strategic things would we do to become faithful? Or maybe a better way to say it would be to be more faithful. What plans could we make? And so please feel free to email me or call me. Man, I'd take you out to lunch. We'll shovel your driveway and get together. I'd love to have that conversation with you. What does it look like as a church for us to be faithful? Today we're doing the end of Matthew 25. So if you would turn there in your Bible with me, it's Matthew 25. I'm going to begin reading in verse 31. It says this, Matthew chapter 25, verse 31. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his throne in heavenly glory, and all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He'll put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. The king will say to those on his right, come, you are blessed by my Father. Take your inheritance for the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. And I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or need clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go and visit you? And the king will reply, I tell you the truth, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. Then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, he who is cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes, and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison, and you did not look after me. And they also will answer, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger in need of clothes or sick or in prison and did not help you? And he will reply, I tell you the truth, whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do for me. And they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you for allowing us to study your word together, even through a virtual platform today, Father. I thank you that your spirit knows no bounds. And Father, we know scripture tells us that when two or more are gathered in your name, that you're with us. And Father, we know that to be gathered in your name is to be gathered in your character, to be gathered in humility. And so, Father, even as we're separate in homes, Father, we collectively ask that you'd speak to us from your word today. Dear Father, would you stir in our hearts? And Father, would you make us a people that are faithful? Father, would you show us intentional steps we can take to be more faithful, to be better stewards of our time and of our resources? Father, our great desire is to please you. Father, we do ask that you would come quickly, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, what we're going to do this morning is we're just going to go just through the passage, just kind of walk through it. So the first thing that we see there in verse 31 is that the Son of Man is coming. Well, we don't know exactly when, but it says there, 31, when the Son of Man comes in his glory. Now, this in his glory really kind of should stir in our minds this thought that this is actually his second coming, and the first time that he came was not in his glory. In fact, the first time he came in humility, didn't he? He came as an infant. He came born in a manger. He came born into poverty and really obscurity, that he was a servant. And I mean, although he was popular, he didn't come showing all of his glory. The second time that he comes, though, it will be in his glory. Now, just to clarify, we would believe, or I believe personally, that this second coming is going to be two parts. We could say there's his return in the air, and that's what we would say is the rapture, whenever he's going to say, you know, come up to us, and, you know, you'll hear the trumpet of the Lord. He'll the dead in Christ will rise, right? And then there'll be the second coming where his feet actually touch the ground, and this time it says that he's going to be coming in all of his glory. In fact, he'll be bringing his angels with him. Now, it's interesting because when you think whenever he came his first time in obscurity, he wasn't necessarily as popular. Maybe people's opinions were different. It was harder to follow a humble man in that regards. If he would have come in all of his glory, well, then, of course, everyone would have wanted to follow him. If he would have showed up in all of his glory, everyone would have said. In fact, you see this now that there's, you know, the paparazzi, and you have some, whether it be some great athlete or some Hollywood actor or actress, that whenever they step out of the car, the crowd surround them. And this has never happened to me. I guess, you know, walking a little bit more of a humble life, not saying that I'm this great humble person, but, you know, like, I'm not popular. So you think Jesus, his first time, there were maybe mixed reviews on him, but whenever he comes the second time, it will be in all of his glory. Everyone will realize this is the King. In fact, this is what it says, right? That he's going to be on his throne. And then it says that he's going to gather all the nations to him. This is our word that we talked about out of Matthew 24, is the word ethne. He's going to be gathering every tribe to him. This shows that now the process is complete. If you look back at Matthew 24, you saw that there were these signs of the times, that these things are progressing. If you kind of reviewed for just a moment in your mind, there are going to be all these, this explosion of false religions. There's going to be civil upheaval. There's going to be wars and rumors of wars. Kingdom will rise against kingdom. And then it says ethne will rise against ethne. And so there's going to be this racial tension at that time. There'll be great natural disasters. There'll be growing. There'll probably be record low temperatures and snowstorms. I'm sorry, that was probably inappropriate, right? There's going to be famines and pestilence, earthquakes. The ocean's going to be in turmoil, it says. There'll be great Christian persecution. There'll be a great falling away. It says the love of most will grow cold. And then the last one of those signs was that the gospel will go to all nations. So he says in Matthew 24:14, and the gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. So you see Matthew 24 says, before the end, the gospel is going to be preached to all nations. And then here, Matthew 25, when it actually is talking about the end, he's going to gather all of these nations. Now, just to clarify, this is not going to be a national judgment. When he talks about how he's going to be sitting on the throne to judge the nations, it's not that he's going to say, well, how did Iraq do, and how did Sudan do, and how did Peru do, and how did, you know, each one of these nations. So instead, he gives this illustration of the sheep and the goats. He's saying that this is just like a shepherd is going to separate the sheep and the goats. In fact, this is a very personal judgment. It says in verse 32, all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people. And so just to clarify, this is a personal judgment. The New American Standard Version and the ESV say one from another. It's an individual judgment that he's going to have on these people. So when you get into chapter 25, he's going to give some, maybe some clarity on what these judgments are going to be for. There's the 10 virgins. We talked about this a couple weeks ago and how we're going to be judged. Are we faithful with our affections? And if we are affectionate, if we do have a true and genuine love for the groom, it's going to lead us to be strategic. And we used maybe a great example of that would be in your marriage. Are you strategic in thinking about how you're going to show your loved one? Just as a side note, it is Valentine's Day. So hopefully you are strategic, or at least right now, at the last moment, you're strategically scrambling to think of a way to sound like you are strategic. So we talked about that. There'll be this judgment on preparedness, you could say. Then Nick preached on the parable of the talents, and that was this love for the master, and specifically a love for his return that causes the faithful steward to be willing to take a risk for his sake, for his master's sake, that he wants to have something to grow his master's kingdom. And so there's the parable of the 10 virgins, the parable of the talents. Then you have the sheep and the goats, and we want to maybe specify here that this isn't so much a parable. In fact, as he teaches through this, this judgment is going to be more of an actual judgment. So we don't have to try to wade through what's the symbolism of the cup of water and what's the symbolism of the person who's in need of clothes. He really only illustrated it with the sheep and the goats, but then went right back into here's what's actually going to happen. Jesus is actually going to come in all of his glory with all of his angels. He's going to sit on the judgment seat, and then he's going to actually judge based on what these people have done, right? So what is the judgment here? Look at verse 35. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. So we're all in agreement here that we're judged on how we treat others, and that these others actually end up being how we treated Christ. But here's the problem. There's a lot of, I guess I could say, wrong interpretations from this passage. This passage is one that's easily manipulated. So let's talk about specifically who these others are. And I like doing the air quote to an empty auditorium. So who are these others? The confusion on who the others are. If we say that the others is everyone, right? So others means just anyone out there, then the problem is what we've essentially created is some type of Christian karma that says if you cut somebody off on the interstate, well, then you better watch out, because for you, we've reserved weeping and gnashing of teeth, right? Ultimately, if you treat others well, then that's kind of like treating Jesus well. And what we've ended up doing is making the golden rule the only rule. And we've said this is going to be the one thing that essentially we're judged on. You can see that theologically this becomes very complicated, that what we end up with is saying, well, this is a pretty good guy. He treated everybody pretty good, so he's probably going to get the pearly gates. And there's no one in Scripture ever who is declared righteous by obeying the law. Paul tells us that there in Romans. And so there's never going to be somebody who treats other people good enough that they get into heaven. So when we read this passage, we can't interpret it to say that when you treat other people well, it's just like treating Jesus well, and therefore you get heaven. So we can't say others is everyone. And then we also can't say a second way that people kind of, I think, misapply this passage is to say that the others are the needy. And in that way, you essentially make a social gospel that says you need to be treating the least of these. So if you see somebody who has absolutely nothing, they don't have any food, they don't have any drink, and you treat them well, that then, you know, Jesus, to some extent in this illustration, disguises himself in some weird way as the least of these. And don't get this wrong. I have no problem with the least of these type of ministries. In fact, we have a lot of passages in Scripture that tell us that we should be caring for the least of these. In fact, in James, it talks about how good religion, essentially, is to look after the orphan and the widow and these people who are in need. So I'm not taking anything away from those passages. I'm just simply saying, this is not one of those passages that says that if you treat the least of these well, that's ultimately what the gospel is. What happens there is you make a social gospel. So just to kind of review some problems that people create with this passage is they make a Christian karma, which is not found in Scripture, that if you treat others well, then everything good, you know, good things will come to you. And then the others would be kind of the social gospel, which is we should look after, create social programs to help other people, because essentially that's like helping Jesus. Nothing against those programs to care for the needy. There's also some odd views. We won't talk much about this, but somebody once said there's nothing that draws crazy like a steeple. And the only thing that, like, there's a multiplier there. If you put a steeple up and then say, let's talk about eschatology, let's talk about end times, boy, you can get a group of crazy people gathered, a good group, right, of crazy people, because people just tend to, whenever you talk about end times, kind of go everywhere mentally. One of the commentaries that I read said that these others that we're treating well actually represent the 144,000 Jews that would repent in the book of Revelation. And so I thought, wow, I don't know how you got that from this passage, but people just, I think you should treat all people well. You think you should treat Jewish people well. But, you know, just this, like, some people will take all these different hoops to try to maybe get application. So let's talk about who are these people, these least of these. The judgment is going to be based on how you've treated these people. So who are we talking about? It's verse 40 and verse 45. Look there with me. First at verse 40. Matthew 25, verse 40. The king will reply, I tell you the truth, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. So the question would be posed, who are Jesus's brothers? The word there is Adelphos, and it's kind of like in the word Philadelphia, the end of the word Philadelphia. Remember, Philadelphia would be brotherly love, and so Delphia there is kind of where we're going to get this brotherly word. And so Jesus actually has asked this question in Matthew chapter 12. Not so much ask it, but in Matthew chapter 12, his mother and his brothers come, and they say, Jesus, we want to talk to you. Please leave the crowd and come talk to us. And Jesus responds in Matthew 12, verse 50, by saying this, whoever does the will of my Father, that is my brother and my mother and my sister. So when Jesus says here in Matthew 25 that these people, these least of these, whatever you've done for the least of these brothers of mine, he's talking about, I believe, the people who are doing the will of God. Look at verse 25, or chapter 25, verse 45. He will reply, I tell you the truth, whatever you did, not for the least of these, you did for me. So who are the least of these? I believe that these are going to be pointing back to the brothers. And the least of them would be saying even the most insignificant of the brothers. This is kind of like in Luke 9, Jesus is talking about this. Whoever welcomes one of these, this is Luke 9, 48. Whoever welcomes this little child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. For he who is the least among you, he is the greatest. He's saying that if you're sent in my name and somebody welcomes you, that's the same as welcoming me. And if you welcome Christ, he's saying, it's the same as welcoming the Father. So ultimately, whenever we read this passage in Matthew 25, what I want to explain to you is that I believe you have a correlation here. These people are not being judged based on good works, but that there's a correlation that they have welcomed not only the message, but they've welcomed the messenger. These two things seem to be tied very closely together. And we know this to be true in our own lives. Often, you first wonder if you can trust the preacher before you trust his message, right? You're going to welcome the messenger before the message. And so this is similar to what happens when Jesus sends out the 12 and then sends out the 70. He sends out the 12 in Matthew chapter 10. He sends out the 70 in Luke chapter 10. We could look at both of those passages, but let's just look here at Matthew 10 instead. Listen to Matthew 10, verse 5. This is now when Jesus sends out, and what I want you to listen for is how, when we read the description of these people who are being sent out, it actually matches the description of the people that are going to be received, how they're going to be treated. So this is Matthew 10, verse 5. These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And proclaim as you go, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the leper, cast out the demons. You will receive, you received without pain, give without pain. Listen to verse 9 now. Acquire no gold or no silver or no copper for your belts, no bag for your journey, and do not take two tunics or extra sandals or a staff. For the laborer deserves what? His food. And whatever town or village you enter, find that it is worthy and stay there until you depart. As you enter a house, greet it. And if the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if not worthy, let your peace return to you. And if anyone will not receive you and will not listen to your words, shake the dust off of your feet and leave that house or that town. Truly I say to you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah than for that town. Behold, I am sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be wise as serpents, innocent as doves. Beware of men, for they will deliver you over to the court, and they will flog you in their synagogues. You will be dragged before governors and kings for my name's sake to bear witness before them and the Gentiles. Here's what he's saying about these 12s when he sends them out. He's saying, I don't want you to take extra clothes. I don't want you to take extra food. I don't want you to worry about those things, about your own provisions. And by the way, when you go out, they're going to capture you. They're going to imprison you, and they're going to beat you. In fact, this list of what's going to happen to them really matches what Jesus said. When you welcome one of my brothers in your name, in my name, you do unto the least of these, it's like doing it unto me. Because Jesus has sent them out as his representatives. Just as Christ came, if you welcome Christ, you've welcomed the Father. If you welcome one that Christ has sent, you've welcomed Christ, right? So he's going to send them out, and he says, what's going to happen to these people? They're going to go out, and they're going to need to be received. They're going to receive their food by the people who open up their homes to them. So to be honest, we realize that you receive the messenger before you receive the message. This is not saying that this passage is not teaching that if you treat other people well, you'll receive eternal life. It's ultimately about, did you receive the messenger? And if you want to, you could look on down to verse 40 of Matthew 10. As you think about this, the 12 being sent out, as he closes that chapter out, he says this, he who receives you receives me, and he who receives me receives the one who sent me. Verse 41 of chapter 10, anyone who receives a prophet because he is a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And anyone who receives a righteous man because he's a righteous man will receive the righteous man's reward. And if anyone gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones because he is my disciple, I tell you the truth, he will certainly not lose his reward. Jesus just sends out the 12 and says, now listen, if anyone even gives you a cup of water, they would be rewarded. Because what they've done is they've received in. So what this passage, I believe, is telling you, it's not saying that you can earn your salvation by treating people well. There's not a single person in Scripture that's saved based on their works. That is simply heresy. You're only saved by faith. But listen, I think the parable is saying that you receive the message into your heart after you've received the messenger into your home. Now, we live in a different context than that. Most of us probably heard the gospel, at least a large majority of us, in an actual church building. But that's just simply not how the gospel was transmitted in the book of Acts. in the book of Acts, what would happen is that people would open up their home to the messenger, and then they would receive the message, right? We see in Acts chapter 2, they met from house to house. Acts chapter 5, they met from house to house. What happens in Acts chapter 10? Peter on a rooftop has a vision to go where? To a man's house. And Cornelius does what? He opens up his home, and when opening up his home, he is saved, he and his whole household. Acts chapter 16, Lydia opens up, it says in Acts chapter 16, verse 14, Lydia opened up her heart to the message. What happens in the very next verse? She says, come into my house and stay. She opens up her home, and there's a church formed in Lydia's house. We could jump on to the Philippian jailer. Same thing happens, miraculous delivery, and he goes and opens up his home, and he feeds them. There seems to be this correlation to opening up your home and then opening up your heart. Now, I realize we don't seem to live in that context. So instead, we live in a society that seems to think that you can have Jesus in your heart but not have Jesus in your home, which is just absurdity, isn't it? In fact, we call that hypocrisy. But yet we don't seem to see that very often in the New Testament, because it seems as though they first open up their home and then open up their heart. And it makes me just kind of ponder this for a second, especially in, you know, God's sovereignty, that now everybody who's listening to this message is probably listening to it from their home. Have you ever considered, we say this phrase often in church, have you asked Jesus into your heart? And maybe I would ask it this way. Have you asked Jesus into your home? Is he really Lord of every room of your house? Is he Lord of every single possession? There seems to be some parallels there. And I hope you can see it. It's interesting when you think about Jesus coming back to judge. And the parables that he's given here, right? So Jesus is coming back. He's going to gather the nations, and he's going to judge them based on these things. Were you faithful with your affections? Were you strategic in your affections? Did it lead you to be prepared, to have preparedness? Then were you faithful with the talents that you were given? Were you willing to risk it all for the reward of the master? And then this question here would be, did you receive the message and the messenger? Did you open up your home? It's just a different way of thinking. And I know so much of this gets lost just because of our context, that we normally come to the church and we gather here. And so there seems to be a disconnect from our homes. But I want you to know, I've been in ministry for over 20 years now. I believe I've preached over 2,500 times. And I pray every time that the Lord does a great work as I preach. I hope that he stirs in people's hearts. I hope that people's hearts are burned, just like when Peter preached and their hearts were pierced. But I have to tell you, I believe I've done more ministry sitting around a kitchen table. I think I've done more ministry leaning on the back of a pickup truck, or sitting on a tailgate, or maybe even driving with somebody to a hunting trip. I know there's many times that I just know I've done, in some ways, better ministry just fishing with somebody and talking to them about the Lord. There seems to be this correlation that when somebody welcomes the messenger, that God opens their heart to welcome the message. I think the danger of what has happened is that in a society where we put the expert in front of everybody, and we build a platform to listen to the great preacher, right? And I know in this church you've had great preachers. Kenny Qualls, I just love that guy. And today in our day and age, you could get on the radio, you could go on TV, you could get on Facebook, and you can watch all of these other great preachers. And the tendency is to think that's where great ministry happens. But Jesus here is saying that he sends these messengers out, and that some of the best ministry that happens is whenever you hand that minister a cup of water and say, would you come into my home? And then in turn, you get to be that minister. And so what this is saying in this passage, I believe, is that you too could do great ministry simply by going to these people, to your friends, to your neighbors, and that when they welcome you in, this is the beginning of fruitful labor, that they open their home, and now you pray, oh Lord, would you allow them to open their hearts? Maybe let me give it to you as an illustration this way. If I was going to teach you how to shoot a basketball, and I know there's some great athletes in our church, so you might think this is laughable, but the way I remember learning it was beef, right, balance, eyes, elbow, follow through. And so, you know, we'd go through the whole motions, take the ball, go through all the stuff to make a good, have a good jump shot. And then I'd say, okay, now it's time to actually shoot. And I went back to half court and just lobbed up from half court and made it. And then say, okay, this is your very first time to shoot a basketball. Here you go. And you had to fling that dude from half court. You'd say, I'm never going to be good at basketball. But that's not what we do, right? Titus has a little basketball goal right now. And so we hang that sucker at like 4 foot high. And then we don't have him shoot from across the house. We put him right next to the goal and let him put it in. And now here, I don't know if this illustration is making sense to you or not. But what happens in ministry often in the American context, we put the preacher up on the stage and we say, do ministry. Show us how you could make one from half court. Send it down range. But the truth is, ministry in Jesus' day was in some ways much simpler. Go knock on this person's door. We call it the house of peace model in Luke chapter 10. And if that person opens up your door, you go in and you dine with them. Here's the thought for you. That when you're thinking of ministry, if you're thinking of your ministry is to stand up and to preach the word, and we have these people that can just take these little details, these little minute things, and preach this dynamic message from it, and the danger is that we can walk away saying, oh, I could never do ministry like that. But Jesus here is saying, here's what I'm going to judge you on. Did you open up your door, and was the messenger faithful? Not so much to preach this magnificent sermon, but to simply come in to break bread with you and to share the gospel with you. And I think what we see in the passage is that the people who were willing to open their home also became the ones that were willing to open their hearts. See, these people, they weren't judged because they gave water or gave food or gave clothes, but that the people who were sent out in Jesus' name, they fit that list. They didn't take food with them. They didn't take water with them. They didn't take extra clothes. And they were often arrested and thrown in prison. And they were beaten. In fact, if you look at the translation of, when were you sick and did I visit you? The translation really is to be made weak. So this person who's been beaten now, the person who goes to them and cares for them, these are the people that were receiving the gospel. They were welcoming not just the message, but the messenger. I want to ask you, when you think about this and you think about ministry, is there a disconnect that you think about ministry as an event that we do or a time during the week? Or do you think that ministry is when God simply sends you to somebody's house that you already know that you get to begin to have conversations with? Or maybe ministry is when you welcome the minister in. I have to say just a little bit of personal application here. Every year we say, hey, we want to do life groups. And so who would be willing to open their home? And I'm not trying to like guilt shame anyone here. But I do think it's interesting that it's sometimes like pulling teeth to say, hey, is there anybody who would open their home? And you read this passage and you think, this is what the passage is teaching, that you'd open your home to strangers. Wouldn't this be productive ministry that we think about these small groups being the front door of our church? You know what we do for outreach? We ask somebody if they want to come over and have a cup of coffee, and we talk to them about the Lord. We begin to open our homes, what we've done to the least of these. How is it that we become the messengers in this parable? I don't know if I've communicated this well or not, but to me this was so eye-opening to read a passage that I've always heard taught like it was a social gospel, that if you treat people well, then one day you're going to get a great reward. But I think the correct application is, the correct teaching is that Jesus sends out his disciples like this. No food, no drink, no money, no extra clothes, no extra tunic, as it says, no place to stay. And there are people that open up their homes, and those seem to be the very homes that also open up their hearts. It'd be a question that I'd have for you today is, have you ever opened up your heart? Have you ever asked Christ to come in, to be Lord of your life? I want to point out one last thing as we close. Verse 34 and verse 41, this is the reward and the condemnation, right? 34 is the reward, 41 is the condemnation. 34, the king will say to those who are on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance for the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. See the word prepared there? This kingdom was prepared for you since the creation of the world. Verse 41. Then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you who are cursed, into eternal fire prepared for who? For the devil and his angels. Here's a thought for you. Did you know that hell wasn't made for you? It wasn't prepared for you. It was prepared for the devil and his angels. And I don't know if this connects with you as well as maybe as I hope it would, that the thought that he created heaven for you, he created you for a relationship with him. He created you since the creation of the world. He's been longing for you. But for those who didn't open up their home and didn't open up their heart to Christ, they never repented of their sins, he's sending them to a place that was not prepared for them. It was prepared for the devil and for his angels. But it is the place that you would be if you've never repented and trusted Christ. A couple things for you as we close. You're sitting there in your home, and hopefully in the warmth of your home. I'd ask you, has there ever been a moment that you said, I want to give my house to the Lord? I want to open up my home. I want this to be a place that's open. I want to be the type of person that is saying, I want to do ministry out of my home. First home that Dawn and I built, the first one that we purchased was in Nixa. And right after purchasing it, I remember Dawn coming to me and saying, we have this house, let's do ministry with it. The very first couple that we got to invite over to that house, young couple, wanted to get married, and we invited them over, got to spend time with them, go through marriage counseling with them. It wasn't long before the Lord called them to go overseas, to go work in India, and you know, who would have known that almost 15 years later, we got to open our house again to that same couple. And not just open our house, but to open our church and to say, Nick and Emily, would you want to come on staff here and to work with us? The Lord has blessed really some of the ministry we've done in our home in a much greater way than ministry we've done in large crowds. Has there ever been a moment that you maybe looked at your spouse and said, man, how could we use our home? How could we leverage this home in this neighborhood to do fruitful ministry, to do what this parable says, to say, let's maybe have a meal, let's you know, we'll have people over for coffee. If there's somebody in need, let us be the home that, let us be the people that don't just open our heart, but we open our home. Has that ever been you? And then secondly, the question of salvation. Has there been a time that you said, I want to open my heart to Christ? We gave this illustration yesterday in Paul's funeral, talking about whether or not you've answered the call. And I would just ask you, there in the solitude of your own home, has there ever been a moment where you truly heard the call of salvation, that God loved you so much that he gave his only son to die for you, and that if you believe in him, you would not perish, but you'd have eternal life? You know, we're closing today, and we won't be closing with a song. I'm going to close with a word of prayer. But I know if you're watching this, you're watching on Facebook Live, man, you can send us a private message if you have any questions about your salvation, or if you just feel like the Spirit has moved in your heart and you say, I want to open up my home to do ministry. I want to think about how I can do ministry through my home, and you'd just like some to start the conversation on that. Man, I'd encourage you to open up that Facebook Messenger app, and you can send a message directly to our church, and we'd love to talk to you about that. The passage here, he's dividing people, not based on works, but I truly believe it's based on, did they welcome the message? And to welcome the message, they first welcomed the messenger. I pray that God would speak to our hearts today. Father, thank you for allowing us to study your word. Father, we do ask that you would allow us to rightly divide the word of truth. And so, Father, if there's any part of today's message that's not true, then Father, I pray that you'd protect it from people's minds and from their ears. Father, I pray that your Spirit would lead us to the truth. And Father, we ask that today you would show each of us that are followers of Christ, how can we use our home for ministry Would you show us how we could use each of our assets, whether it be the food or the drink that we have, or the people we know that are hurting that we can care for. Father, protect us from having just another social gospel. Father, we know that you send people out in your name. Father, would you allow us to walk in that? Would you allow us to be people who go house to house, as you've told them there in Luke chapter 10, and that we'd look for that house of peace, that person that we'd come in that would receive us, and that we pray would receive the message. Father, for those who hear the message today that aren't saved, would you speak to their heart? Father, would you lead them to repentance? Father, we love you and we thank you for this day. Thank you for your grace and for your mercy. It's in Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. We started with the word today, but I know Nick has included a couple different worship songs, and so you can find those there on the Facebook Live feed and hopefully spend some time worshiping with your family. Church, we love you. Stay safe and warm. It's such an honor to get to minister with you. We love you.